Part of what NASA does is to make the impossible possible. We do that on a regular basis, and we continue to do that with the Artemis program and as we look forward to going to Mars. But I want to talk to you about making the impossible possible in your journeys. And I want to share my journey with you as an illustration. Because the truth of it is, I should not be standing in front of you today talking about my experience as an astronaut. If the laws of logic and reason applied, I shouldn't be up here today wearing this blue suit, Robinson Colors flight suit. And I'll tell you why. I've wanted to be an astronaut for as long as I can remember. I was inspired by science fiction, by books, by movies like Star Wars, and books like the, what was the name of that book? It was, Runaway Robot. It's the first book I remember reading about, science fiction book I remember reading, and it was about a little kid that lived on Ganymede and had a personal robot, and they had adventures, and I thought, wow, that would be really cool to have a personal robot and go have adventures on Ganymede. But it wasn't until second grade, my teacher, Mrs. Loudon, wheeled a television into our classroom at New Baden Elementary School in Illinois, and we watched the very first shuttle launch. On April 12, 1981, Space Shuttle Columbia lifted off into low Earth orbit. And that's when it clicked for me that this dream of living and working in space was not fiction, that this is something that we could actually do, and I was hooked. And so now I had to figure out how to make that dream come true. So no internet back in those days. I think we barely had a Xerox machine. I remember running Dittos, right? Yeah. So I had to figure out, how do I become an astronaut? And so I read accounts of our early space program and biographies of our early astronauts. And it seemed like all of those folks early on were pilots and then test pilots. And so I decided for myself, that's what I want to do. I want to become a pilot, and then maybe I can become a test pilot, and then someday maybe I can become an astronaut. And so I set my sights on becoming a pilot. Very grateful to have an incredibly supportive family at home that said, hey, whatever you want to do, you can do. Just work hard at it. And so my folks right here, sitting right here in the front, were a huge part of that support, that I could pull this off. And I figured, if I want to become a pilot, I'm going to join the Air Force. And if I want to join the Air Force, I want to go to the Air Force Academy. And so I sent off for information. I filled out a little card that I found in a magazine and sent off for information from the Air Force Academy. And I never heard back from them. It was probably because I was living in England and 11 years old at that time, but that's all right. I didn't let that get me down. And so living in England, I finished my freshman year and actually moved here, started my sophomore year here at Robinson, and graduated in 1991 and had the great fortune to be accepted in the Air Force Academy. So I was on my path. Everything was going according to plan. At the Air Force Academy, I studied biology, pre-med, but still wanted to fly. And after graduating from the Air Force Academy and doing some graduate work, I went to pilot training. Still on that path, everything going according to plan. At pilot training, about a third of the way through my first aircraft, through the first phase, I went to the flight surgeon with what I thought was a cold, and he hemmed and hawed and tapped his chin and decided to ground me at that point to do some further testing. He thought maybe I had asthma, and I thought, that's really strange. I don't feel like I've got asthma, but that's fine. I can wait this out, get back in the cockpit, and continue on my path. And that dragged on and on. Dragged on for 6 months. So during that time, I thought, boy, I think I'm definitely going to get back into flying. But just in case, I am going to I'm going to do something to provide an alternative, just in case they don't let me to continue to fly. So I took night classes. I started preparing for med school entrance exams, and I started applying to medical schools. And then at the end of that 6 months, the Air Force came back, and I had my medical evaluation board, and they said, hey, not only are we not going to let you fly, we're going to kick you out of the Air Force. We don't need your services anymore. And I said, okay. So I appealed that decision because I didn't have issues, and I thought, this is ridiculous. And I felt a debt to the Air Force for all the investment they had made in me. And so I fought that. And on appeal, the Air Force came back and said they upheld their decision. And so I was to be medically discharged from the Air Force. So let's talk about impossible. Is it possible to be medically kicked out of the Air Force and become an astronaut? In my mind, the answer is no. There is no line that connects medically discharged from the service to becoming a NASA astronaut. And so for me, that meant a complete obliteration of a dream, of not just getting to fly in the Air Force, but the dream of becoming an astronaut. That dream is now impossible. And so that was a dark time for me. That was the probably the most devastating occurrence in my professional career. Where do you go from there? For me, it felt like I had descended into this valley of despair, because a plan that I had been working on for up to 10 years at that point was now completely obliterated. So I'm grateful for my family, my friends, for my faith that helped me kind of rebuild from that situation and figure out a path forward. I remember that my classmates in pilot training, after a year of training, they were getting ready to graduate. And that was so I was going to their graduation party, so excited for them, but a bittersweet time, because as I saw them get their Air Force wings, and as I saw them choose the plane that they were gonna get to fly in the Air Force, I felt like I should have been there too, but I wasn't. My journey with the Air Force was coming to an end. The next day, my wife and I decided to go to a neighboring town to find a coffee shop to just sit in and hang out. We stopped by the mailbox on the way, and in that mailbox, on the day after my pilot training class graduated, was a big packet from the University of Colorado School of Medicine. I'd been accepted to medical school. And so there was a path that I could follow. For me, medicine represented an opportunity to challenge myself and to serve my community, and this was the path that I would pursue. So after leaving the Air Force, I went to school. Graduating from medical school, I decided to pursue emergency medicine. Went up to Minneapolis. Now, as a part of that program, we take care of patients in the hyperbaric chamber. This is a chamber where you go in, they increase the pressure, and we use that to take care of patients that maybe have carbon monoxide poisoning or a diving injury. And you can't do that and have asthma, so I had to get tested. So I went in to get tested for asthma, and they said, "You don't have asthma." I thought, okay. And so I got tested multiple other times because my life had been dramatically changed as a result of that diagnosis. And I was cleared of that diagnosis. And so I thought to myself, there's still a possibility that I could serve in human spaceflight in some way. And so after finishing emergency medicine, I went on to train in aerospace medicine and then got a job as a flight surgeon at NASA, working as a doctor that takes care of the crew. And a year into that job, NASA announced another astronaut selection. And so I threw my hat into the ring. And in 2009, I joined the 20th astronaut class. So the reason that I tell you that story is that I want you to understand to not buy into the impossible. People will tell you that things are impossible. You will convince yourself that things are impossible. But I want to share with you the three things that I think that helped me make the impossible possible, that helped me get from that time where my dreams had been obliterated to this time where I get to stand in front of you and share with you what it's like to live and work in space. And so the first thing is something that we all know, but it's hard to accept. To make the impossible possible requires hard work. It's what we did in Apollo. It's what we did in Mercury. It's how we got people on the surface of the moon. It's how we launched the space shuttle. It's how we spend 6 months living and working in low Earth orbit. And it's how I got from the day that I got kicked out of the Air Force to this position is hard work. Nobody told me to take night classes to prepare for the med school entrance exams. I was a casual status officer with no job. I could have just hung out at the pool, worked out, did the minimum amount of work in my Air Force job, and called it a day. Nobody told me to apply to medical schools. No internet applications back then. This is filling out paper applications to 12 different medical schools and getting 11 rejection letters back, but one offer for an interview that worked out. Hard work. There's no substitute, and hard work will open doors for you to the point that even as you pursue your goal, that there are so many open doors that you may decide, you know what, that dream of mine is pretty cool, but I actually, this other opportunity seems really good. We have invited folks to come to interview for the astronaut office because they have worked hard and proven themselves. And as they got that application, those opportunities had opened up to them that there was another opportunity that was more appealing. And they declined the invitation. Hard work. The second element is teamwork. That is how we got to the moon. It's how we get to space station. And it's how you make the impossible possible. This achievement of becoming an astronaut and getting to fly in space is not an individual achievement. It is a reflection of all of the people that have been a part of this journey. Teachers, mentors, family, friends, coaches, classmates, teammates, people sitting in this room like Mrs. Keim, my math teacher. And Brian Hazard, my wrestling teammate and now multi-state state winner coach here at Robinson. It's people like that are walking alongside you and investing in you that make these things possible. We get to the space station not on our own. It is on the shoulders of flight controllers, trainers, engineers that make that possible. Making the impossible possible takes teamwork. And finally, kindness. It's a little crazy, but help people along the way. Kindness, true kindness is not a transactional thing. Hey, if I do something for you, nice for you, do something nice for me. It is the intentional looking out for other people, friends and family, and people that are not your friends. But if you're thinking about how you can make somebody's day better, how you can be an encouragement to them, you are being empathic. You're thinking outside of yourself. You're being unselfish. And I think it's Ronald Reagan that said that there's no limit to the good that you can do if you don't care who gets the credit. We actually, as a part of our ethos of living on space station, kindness is one of the two pillars of what we do up there. We describe self-care and team care. Self-care being getting yourself prepared, making sure that you're ready for the day, getting squared away, and all your work done so that you can now look outward and see how you can help your team. Kindness. Hard work, teamwork, and kindness. And those are the things that I feel that have made the impossible possible in my life. I'm so grateful for Robinson and the part that it played in this journey. It gave me a foundation, a launch pad for my dreams and set me on a trajectory that has come full circle so that I'm able to come back here and share with you all today. Thank you so much for being a part of that journey.